Yes, you may walk with a limp. Most of us do, in some way or other. But the picture is here that despite the fact you might walk with a limp and you carry the legacy, that God is making another pot that is good and fulfills His purpose.
Just suppose God searched through heaven and couldn't find one willing to be the supreme sacrifice that was needed for to buy eternal life for you and me. And oh, had it not been for a place called Mount Calvary, and had it not been for the old rugged cross, and had it not been for the man we call Jesus, then forever my soul so glad He was willing to drink this bitter cup. And although He prayed, "Father, let it pass from me," yet I'm so glad He never called on heaven's angels. From these hands, oh, the nails that torment me. Oh, had it not been for a place called Mount Calvary, and had it not been for the had it not been for the man we call Jesus, then forever my soul would be lost. Then forever my soul be lost. Ooh, ooh, ooh.
Living Truth receives letters and emails from all over the world. They tell us how God is at work in people's lives through our broadcasts.
I thoroughly enjoy the teaching of Charles Price, not only the depth, but the clarity of all his teaching sessions. It has helped me in my spiritual growth as a Christian. My Sundays are planned around listening to you and your inspired teaching messages. Thank you again, Jean.
Kudos to Charles Price and the Living Truth Ministry. I feel blessed and inspired every time I experience the Living Truth on television, and I pray that as many people as possible will have the opportunity to experience your ministry as I have. Thank you for all that you do to encourage me to do my best to honor God and to understand and live by the will of God on earth as it is in heaven. Thank you. Russell Burnham, Toronto, Ontario.
What is your story? Write to us or send an email through our website. We love to hear from you, and we reply to all our mail. Thanks for your feedback to Living Truth.
On today's program, Charles Price continues the series, Living in the Will of God. Rather than asking, what is the will of God for my life? We should be asking, how does the role and purpose of my life conform to the general will of God? This week is entitled, Reworking the Clay.
If you've got a Bible with you, I'm going to read from the book of Jeremiah, chapter 18, one of the Old Testament prophets. I'm going to read to you in a moment the first six verses. Before I read them, let me set the context for this, because for a number of weeks we've been talking about living in the will of God. And before we look at some of the issues of personal guidance, which are probably important to many of us, we're looking at some of the big picture issues of how God works out His will in our world. Last week we talked about a dilemma that Scripture presents us with. In 1 John chapter 5, John wrote there that the whole world is under the control of the evil one. Jesus three times called Satan the prince of this world. Paul called him the God of this age. He also called him the ruler of the kingdom of the air. And these, you will agree, are lofty descriptions. And we see the fingerprints of Satan all over the place. We see the evidence of these statements all over the place. Yet at the same time, we looked at Job's confidence when at the end of the book of Job, having been subject to explicit satanic attack, he wrote this. He said to God, I know you can do all things and no purpose of yours can be thwarted. And we tried to draw a distinction between processes and purpose. There are many processes of our experience of life that have the fingerprints of Satan on them and his activity. We live in a fallen world. We are ourselves fallen. We are ourselves corrupted. And yet, in the midst of those processes which involve evil, there is a purpose that Job says of God, no purpose of yours can be thwarted. You're working out a purpose in all of this. And we talked a bit about that last week. And the reason why I remind you of that, because I want to build on that this morning a little bit. In talking about the sovereignty of God in situations that are wrong or situations that have gone wrong or situations that are self-imposed as wrong things. And I want to do so by reading this story in Jeremiah chapter 18. Reading from verse 1. This is the word that came to Jeremiah from the Lord. Go down to the potter's house, and there I will give you my message. So I went down to the potter's house and I saw him working at the wheel. But the pot he was shaping from the clay was marred in his hands. So the potter formed it into another pot, shaping it as seemed best to him. Then the word of the Lord came to me, O house of Israel, can I not do with you as this potter does, declares the Lord. Like clay in the hand of the potter, so are you in my hand, O house of Israel. That's as far as I'm going to read, but don't close your Bible. We're going to pick up later parts from this passage as well. I knew a man extremely well who believed that when he was a young man as a student at an agricultural college, he had disobeyed God in such a way that he believed he had destroyed what had been God's purpose for his life. I don't know the details of what had actually happened, But I do know he lived with a sense of being second best and living not the plan that God had for him, but an inferior plan. He continued to love God. He continued to read his Bible every day. He prayed every day. I don't know anyone who is more diligent in his daily devotions with God, both morning and evening, as he was. I knew him well because he was my father. And he died about 4 years ago. But he lived most of his life with this sense, I stepped out of the will of God and I can't get back in. I don't know whether there's anybody here this morning who feels that, maybe not in the same measure or the same set of circumstances, but maybe there are things you look back on in your life that you feel have disqualified you from being what God wants you to be. Of course, it's true, we can disobey God. We can move out of his will, that is true. But the question I want to ask and address this morning is, what happens to the will of God when you have stepped out of what you sensed was his will and purpose for you? And the answer to that is what we'll talk about this morning from this story in Jeremiah chapter 18, where God sent Jeremiah down to visit the house of a potter. And he watches the potter at work, and in the course of his work, the clay becomes marred. It doesn't tell us why it becomes marred, because that is irrelevant to the point. The point is it becomes marred. And what the potter does is he remolds the marred clay into something else. And I love the qualification attached to it, as seemed best to him. This is the best thing I can do. It's not the original purpose, and it's not the second best. Jeremiah 18 follows Jeremiah 17. And in order to interpret any part of Scripture well, we have to look at the context for it. And I'm going to just pull out one or two things that will help give some clarity to this, I think. But the focal point I want to look at with you is the work of the potter with his marred clay. But in chapter 17, the previous chapter in verse 12, there's this statement that says, a glorious throne exalted from the beginning is the place of our sanctuary. A sanctuary is a place where you go for refuge, a place you can go to hide, a place you can go to be protected. And he says, this is what we have, a glorious throne. That is the sovereignty of God on his throne. That is the place where we go to for refuge, he says. That is the place of our sanctuary. That is where we find our security. And what is that glorious throne? What is the sovereignty of God? Is it a fixed, rigid pattern that if you break out of it, you're out of it forever, like a map on a wall which you can't change? Well, in chapter 18, he explains it to us. That the sovereignty of God, the place of our refuge, is that God in his sovereignty as the potter with the clay has all through history, and I'll show you this in a few moments, and he does in your life and mine, he remolds according to whatever the clay is in his hand. See, Jeremiah's watching the potter at work here. The focus is on the potter. And because it becomes marred, something goes wrong with it. He forms it into another pot, shaping it as seemed best to him. And he gives an explanation in verse 6, where he says, O house of Israel, can I not do with you as this potter does? Like clay in the hands of the potter, so are you in my hands. And if that clay has become marred, and if that clay has become damaged in some way, then the potter remolds it into something that is good, that seems best. In verse 9 and 10, a little bit later there, in Jeremiah 18, if at another time I announce that a nation or a kingdom is to be built up and planted, and if it does evil in my sight and does not obey me, then I will reconsider the good I'd intended to do for it. So here's the situation where he says regarding the nation of Israel, if it does evil in my sight, if it doesn't obey me, what does the potter do? Does he throw it away? Does he discard it? Does he put it on the trash heap? No. I reconsider the good that I had intended to do it and remold it into something that seems best. He remolds the clay into something else. You see, I have no doubt that this building this morning is full of marred clay. I myself am marred clay. There are things in our lives, things in our history we cannot undo. At times we've rebelled against God. We're all by nature sinful. We start off on the wrong foot. We start off with a bent towards rebellion and going our own way and doing our own thing. We start off marred. And the picture here, what is the will of God in that situation? Is it, well, you can descend into some kind of second class living? Yes, it'll be okay, but it's only second class. No, the picture is here that if the clay is yielded, and we'll talk about the clay needing to be soft and pliable, when the clay is yielded, he forms it into another pot, shaping it as seemed best to him, not shaping it second best, but as seemed best to him. I don't know what lies in your past, but there are folks here who carry in your life secrets, maybe they're secrets, or you carry a history that has been damaging to you. Maybe you've been through an abortion. Maybe you're the father of the fetus or the mother. You can't go back and undo that. Maybe you've been through a divorce and it was painful to you and painful to your spouse and painful to your children if there were children involved. And going back seems out of the question. It may not be, but maybe it seems it is. I get letters quite often from people in prison because our television program, Living Truth, is shown across the country and other parts of the world. It seems that in Canada, the United States, the prisoners can watch TV on Sunday morning. And maybe more often, but several have told me in letters that a group of them meet together Sunday morning and they watch the program. And I get letters from people, and I'm in correspondence with one or two folks in that situation, and some of them in horrendous situations. One man I'm in communication with who is in prison for life. He murdered his own wife. And he's come to know Christ in the prison and writes beautiful letters. He can't go back. He can't undo that. Maybe it's things have been done to you. Maybe you're molested as a child, and out of that has grown a confused sexuality and all the repercussions of that. Or you were damaged in earlier years, and there's a legacy from that damage, and it's impacted your ability to trust. The clay can be damaged in many ways. It says the clay is damaged in the potter's hand, not damaged by the potter, though it was in his hand. Many of the damages are self-inflicted. But here's the message of this story, and it's a message of hope, that the potter does not take it off the wheel and discard it. He reworks it, forming it into another pot. Yes, different, because this history is now part of this new pot, as seemed best to him. You see, nobody and no experience is irredeemable in our lives. I didn't say everything is fixable, because it's not. And sometimes we have to walk through life with a limp like Jacob. Do you remember Jacob who wrestled with God? And Jacob, the very name Jacob, means twister and cheat, and he was all of that. He lived up to his name. And one day God met him, and in that intriguing story when God takes on physical form, as often in the Old Testament scriptures, you have that in what we call a theophany, where God is incarnate in a human form, and he meets with Jacob, and they wrestle, and they throw each other to the ground, and they fight on the ground, and eventually God knocks his thigh out of joint. And eventually Jacob clings to him and says, I will not let you go unless you bless me. He'd been the antagonist. Now he clings to him, won't let him go. And Jacob walked with a limp for the rest of his days. Yes, you may walk with a limp. Most of us do, in some way or other. But the picture is here that despite the fact you might walk with a limp and you carry the legacy, that God is making another pot that is good and fulfills his purpose. Now, he's talking about the nation of Israel here in Jeremiah and their history prior to this already demonstrates this. When Israel came into the land of Canaan, God set them up as a nation, and they were to be a theocracy, not a democracy. There was no such thing, nor a monarchy. They were to be a theocracy. What that meant was that God was to be their king. And what that meant was that he would raise up men or women. He'd put his Holy Spirit on them. People would recognize God's anointing on them and God's empowering of them. They were known as judges, and for over 300 years, Israel lived as a theocracy. But after a while, the Israelites became very insecure and unsettled about this. And they decided they wanted to be like everybody else around them. And in 1 Samuel 8, they came to Samuel, who was the last judge, and they said, "We want a king over us. Then we'll be like all the other nations with a king to lead us and to go out before us and fight our battles." This was good strategic thinking on their part. Let's align ourselves with where everybody else operates. Let's be able to predict who the next king is going to be so we can start to train him from the time he's a boy, or the next queen, and start to train him from the time she's a little girl. Let's be gone with this uncertain, speculative, who is going to be the next leader? And so to their own thinking, this was a good move forward. And God spoke to Samuel about this in 1 Samuel 8 and verse 7 and said to him, "Listen to the people that are saying this to you. It is not you they have rejected. They've rejected me as their king." Samuel, don't take this personally. You're the last judge. It's not you they're rejecting. It's me they're rejecting. So God is unambiguous about that. And then he says this. "So, I will give them a king." And he tells Samuel who that king is going to be. He was to go and find him. His name was Saul. Samuel anointed Saul, and as he did so, the Spirit of God came on him. This is God anointing this man now, not just, oh, well, you go and do your own thing and you're going to get into a big mess. No, God anoints him. The Spirit of God comes on him. Saul demonstrates the evidence the Spirit of God is on him by being given victory in a battle, the first battle he goes into. Then you know the story of Saul, how he did mess up, of course. But then God said to Samuel, because Saul has disobeyed me, I want you to go and find another king. He's a man after my own heart. Go down to Bethlehem, to the house of Jesse, and he found the man. His name was David, the youngest son of Jesse. David became king. The Spirit of God came upon David. He gives us some of the most beautiful texts of Scripture in the Psalms, in the poetry of the Psalms. Every succeeding king is described either as a king who walked in the ways of his father David and obeyed the Lord, or as one who did not walk in the ways of his father David and disobeyed the Lord. And when you open the New Testament, the very first word, the New Testament, very first sentence is the genealogy of Jesus Christ, the son of David. Now, David should never have been king of Israel in God's original purpose for the nation. But because they rebelled, because they turned away from God's plan and purpose and demanded their own king, God remolded the clay. Was David second class? No, David becomes the hero. And Jesus, the Messiah, is known as the son of David in the line of kingship. Because God remolds the clay. This is the sovereignty of God. The sovereignty of God is not that everything is in a fixed, predetermined pattern that will never be changed. But the sovereignty of God is his working in the midst of a broken world, in the midst of rebellion, disobedience, remolding clay, including you and including me. After Jeremiah, Jonah was sent to Nineveh. And you know, he ran in the opposite direction, but then eventually he went to Nineveh. And God gave him a message. Thus says the Lord, 40 more days and Nineveh will be destroyed. And in those 40 days that Jonah preached that message, the people became so fearful of the judgment of God that they repented and they believed. And then it says God repented of his plan to destroy Nineveh. Why? He remolded the clay, this time from something negative to something positive, because the circumstances, the context changed. And God remolds the clay according to how it is. You know, sometimes people talk about God having a primary will and a secondary will, or an absolute will and a permissive will. All these are attempts to deal with the fact that when we're out of the will of God, we're not abandoned, and that is fine. Whether those terms are good and helpful, I'm not sure, but I do know there are many of us here this morning, and if God has a primary will and a secondary will, we're definitely in the secondary will, if not the third, fourth, fifth. We would feel that. But no, it's not a question of first and second. It's a question of dealing with the realities of the situation. And you may have gone in the wrong direction. You may have married the wrong person. See, if somebody came to me and said, I have a girlfriend and I'm a Christian, she's not a Christian, do you think it's okay for me to marry her? I would say, well, if you want to know the will of God on that, turn to 2 Corinthians chapter 7, and you'll find a passage there which talks about a believer not being unequally yoked to an unbeliever, and that applies to marriage. And no, it would not be the will of God for you to marry an unbeliever. But if you then went ahead and did it anyway, and you came back a week later and said, you know, we did get married a week ago, and boy, I realized what a huge mistake this was. What is the will of God for me now? I would tell you the will of God for you now is you stay married and make that marriage work. Did God change his mind between before you got married and after you got married? No, you changed the situation. And the will of God works out in whatever context and situation that you're in. But if he's talking here about molding and remolding clay, then the clay has to be soft in order to be moldable, to be pliable, to be submissive. You see, this is not a case of, well, live any old how, and God is constantly correcting you and making it work out okay anyway, even though you mess up. No, don't understand that from this. That is not the message that Jeremiah is giving here. But that when somebody comes with that spirit of humility and surrender and submissive, pliable heart, then God molds into something that seems best to him. What happens if you stay hard and you don't become soft and submissive and you don't confess, because that's all involved in that, is confession of our sin and humble receiving of forgiveness where we've gone wrong? What happens if you stay hard? Well, look at chapter 19 of Jeremiah, the next chapter. It gives us a warning about hard clay, because verse 1, this is what the Lord says, go and buy a clay jar from a potter. Take along some of the elders of the people and of the priests and go out to the valley of Ben Hinnom near the entrance of the potsherd gate and there proclaim the words I tell you. I'm not going to read the words, I'll summarize them in just a moment. But he says, go to the house of a potter, maybe the same potter. This time, don't go to the potter himself, who's at work at the wheel. That's the focus of chapter 18. Now go to a pot that is in its hardened final state. And take this pot and go and stand in front of the people and declare this word. And basically the message is, and you can read it in the following verses, that you have forsaken me, says God. You've replaced me with foreign gods. You've built altars to Baal. Your hearts have become hard against me. And therefore, as a result, it is not now remolding the clay that is the option. It is breaking the clay. It is the judgment of God. And so in verse 10, then he says, break the jar while those who go with you are watching. And say to them, this is what the Lord Almighty says, I will smash this nation and this city just as this potter's jar is smashed and cannot be repaired. And in verse 14, Jeremiah then returned from Topheth, where the Lord had sent him to prophesy, and stood in the court of the Lord's temple and said to all the people, this is what the Lord Almighty, the God of Israel, says, listen, I'm going to bring on this city and the villages around it every disaster I pronounced against them, because they were stiff-necked and they would not listen to my words. In other words, they've got beyond the stage of being soft. They've become hardened. You know, I was meeting with somebody yesterday who is not a believer. Though when he was young, he used to go to a Sunday school in a gospel hall out near Mississauga. But he's not been in church for many years. And I met him yesterday for breakfast. We had had some contact and we have met before, we met again yesterday. And he asked me an interesting question. He said, why are you Christians afraid to talk about the judgment of God? He said, when I used to go to that Gospel Hall Sunday school, we heard that God was a judge as well as a friend. But you folks never talk about that these days. Why not? It's a good question from an unbeliever, though he's going to be a believer soon. Hmm. Because I explained to him the cross yesterday and the judgment of God. When I finished explaining the cross, he said, you know, that makes forgiveness totally logical. Because somebody else has borne it. So he's not far away from the kingdom. But it was a good question. You cannot read the biblical record and stick your head in the sand about the fact that God is judge. And that God, in his grace and mercy, will remold the clay that is soft and pliable. But he will smash the clay jar that is not. That's the picture God gives to Jeremiah to give to the people of Israel. They didn't like it. If you read chapter 20, a man called Pasha, who was the chief officer in the temple in Jerusalem, was indignant about this, and he had Jeremiah beaten up and put into the stocks. We don't talk about a God who's going to smash us as a nation, he said. We are called by God to be his nation. Jeremiah, don't you dare talk like that. But the two pictures that are given in Jeremiah 18, 19 about living in the will of God is this, that when things go wrong, when our hearts become softened again before God and we come in humility, acknowledging all the mess and the failure that is part of our lives, and we confess it so we know his forgiveness and we become pliable again in his hands and responsive again in his hands, he does rework us into another pot that seems best. May not be the original version, but it seems best to him. But the message goes on, if you remain hard and you become resistant and you become rigid, then he has to break the jar. The judgment of God is a very real thing. And the judgment of God is associated with hardness. Remember Pharaoh? How that 14 times in the book of Exodus, it tells us that Pharaoh's heart was hardened. Now, people pick up the fact it says God hardened Pharaoh's heart, and they get all worked up about that. But there are 14 times it says Pharaoh's heart was hardened. 8 of those times say Pharaoh hardened his heart. And 6, which include the last 5 times it's mentioned, it says God hardened his heart. Because, you see, Pharaoh had set the disposition towards God of resistance and hardness. So every time God came again to Pharaoh, the impact of God coming on Pharaoh is that his hardened heart was hardened even more. And God had to smash him in the language of Jeremiah 19. There's a king called Zedekiah. And it says of him in 2 Chronicles 36 that he became stiff-necked and hardened his heart and would not turn to the Lord, the God of Israel. So God had to smash him. He would not turn. He would not become responsive and pliable in the hand of God. Ezekiel, in Ezekiel 3, verse 7, God said to Ezekiel, but the house of Israel is not willing to listen to you because they're not willing to listen to me. For the whole house of Israel is hardened and obstinate. Ezekiel, they won't listen to you because they won't listen to me. And here's the reason. They are hard. They're obstinate. God had to smash them. In the New Testament, there are other occasions of that. Nebuchadnezzar, where Daniel writes that his heart became arrogant and hardened with pride, and he was deposed from his royal throne and stripped of his glory. His hardened heart, he was smashed. Mind you, it's still never the last word, because Nebuchadnezzar himself, from his brokenness, began to seek after God. And one of the great testimonies of the Old Testament scriptures is Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, actually turned to the God of Israel. And Daniel chapter 4 is a tract that was distributed throughout the whole Babylonian Empire. And it's found its way into our Bibles, where Nebuchadnezzar says, I want the whole of my kingdom to know how I came to know the God of Israel. But he'd been broken and smashed before that. So it's never the end. There's always the possibility of restoration when the heart itself begins to soften again. And Hebrews chapter 3 warns us as believers in verse 13 to encourage one another as long as it is called today, so that none of you may become hardened by sin's deceitfulness. And the hardened heart becomes resistant to God and resistant to the will of God. And by the way, he's warning believers in Hebrews 13 about that possibility where you do not find your life being used and purposeful because the hardening of your heart has prevented the molding of the clay. I ask you this morning, how about your life and my life? There's hope here, you see, that no matter what it is that had gone on, no matter what it is you've done, no matter what it is that my father had done and got involved in when he was a student, whatever it was, a softened, pliable, submissive heart can be molded again into something good. The molding can be painful, of course it can be. But it brings something that's good at the end of it. I want to finish with reading you a little fable that I picked up. It says, a husband and wife were in a gift shop looking for something to give to their granddaughter for her birthday. Suddenly, the woman spots a beautiful vase. Look at this lovely piece of work, she said to her husband. And he picked it up and said, you're right. This is one of the most beautiful vases I've ever seen. At that point, the vase talks. And it says to the grandparents, thank you for the compliment, but I wasn't always beautiful. And the grandfather said, what do you mean you weren't always beautiful? Well, said the vase, once I was just an ugly, soggy lump of clay. But one day, a man with dirty, wet hands threw me onto a wheel. Then he started turning me around and around till I got so dizzy I couldn't see straight. Stop! Stop, I cried. But the man with the wet hands said, not yet. And then he started to poke me and punch me until I hurt all over. Stop! Stop, I cried. But the man said, not yet. Each time I thought he was finished, he would crumble and roll me up and begin to poke and punch me again. Finally, he did stop. But then he did something much worse. He put me into a furnace. It got hotter and hotter until I couldn't stand it. Stop! Stop, I cried. But the man said, not yet. Finally, when I thought I was going to burn up, the man took me out of the furnace. And some lady began to paint me. And the fumes got so bad, they made me feel sick. Stop! Stop, I cried. Not yet, said the lady. Finally, she did stop. But then she gave me back to the man. And he put me back into that awful furnace. This time it was hotter than before. Stop! Stop! I cried. But the man said, not yet. Finally, he took me out of the furnace and let me cool. When I was completely cool, a lady put me on this shelf next to this mirror. And when I looked at the mirror, I could not believe what I saw. I was no longer ugly, soggy and dirty, I was beautiful, firm and clean. It was then I realized without all of that pain, I'd still be the ugly, soggy lump of wet clay. It was then all I'd had to endure took on new meaning for me. It's a bit twee, I know. But it's the picture of God taking the clay and molding it. And I don't know where you are this morning, of course. I don't know what marring of the clay has gone on this week. I don't know what knots have built up in the clay that make it difficult for the potter to make what he was making, but he will work on it and remold it. With all the history and all the past and all the experience, good and bad, that your life has consisted of. Because he's forming it into another pot that seems best to him. You see, the will of God is not some fixed, indelibly written plan that you and I have no hope of ever getting into because we've fallen. But the will of God is a living, dynamic molding of your life, molding through your circumstances, molding through the experiences of life into something that is good. It's a prayer. Have thine own way, Lord. Have thine own way. Thou art the potter. It's Old English, of course, but that's okay. Thou art the potter. I am the clay. And here's the invitation. We're saying to God, mold me and make me after thy will while I am waiting, yielded and still. And maybe some of us in a new way, because there are things you felt, you know, that has so spoiled my life. Say, Lord, take that thing, that bad thing, that wrong thing. That thing maybe was done to me, that marred me. Mold me and make me after your will. While I'm waiting, yielded and still.
To watch this message again, go to our website, livingtruth.ca. You can also order DVDs and CDs, download transcripts, sign up for our monthly newsletter, check out the Living Truth Daily Devotional, sign up for podcasts, and read faith stories from other viewers. We love to hear from you, so send us your comments and testimonies. Living Truth is supported by viewers like you. Thank you for transforming lives through your financial participation. Tune in again next week for another message from Charles Price, Visions from Heaven. In life, we constantly have to make important decisions. So how do we discern the will of God for our lives?
The first question needs to be, what is the will of God? Period. If we ask as our first question, what is the will of God for my life? The focal point, the central point is me. But if the question is, what is the will of God? The starting point and the focal point is, what is God doing that is bigger than me, of which I may be a part?
There is no set formula for discerning the will of God, but the Bible does give us some guidelines. This 9-part series, Living in the Will of God, will point you in the right direction and help you avoid some of the pitfalls. Write to Living Truth to order by mail or call Canada, +1 416 222 3341, extension 113, or contact us through our website, livingtruth.ca.
The Quantico family came to Canada from the Philippines in 2003. Like all immigrants, they worked hard to build a new life in a new country. The Quanticos came to People's Church 7 years ago. They connected with other Filipinos and found a sense of community. Their faith began to grow as they listened to the teaching of Charles Price. That faith stirred them into action.
We cannot afford to just sit and just listen. We have to go and share this to others.
I believe that we immigrants were sent here by the Lord, not only to have a good living, but also for Filipinos back home. It's something that has of eternal value for our folks back home.
The Quanticos began to think about how they could bring Charles' teaching to the Philippines. They discussed it with their Bible study group. All agreed it was badly needed.
And of course, we're very fearful because of, you know, we're not like, you know, media people. We're just immigrants here in Canada. So there were a lot of apprehension, but God led the way. He opened the way.
Three Filipino Bible study groups came together to embrace the vision of getting Living Truth on air in the Philippines.
They just responded positively, saying, yes, we can do this by God's grace.
Hannah did some research, and she found out it would cost $770 to buy airtime for 3 months for a daily half-hour radio program. Living Truth provided sample copies of the program. Hannah sent them to the radio station to find out if they would broadcast them. But she didn't know how they could possibly raise the money.
That's the thing about giving. We were just so amazed how the funds poured in as soon as we shared about this vision and about this ministry project in the Philippines.
It seems as though that they have been waiting for this chance, for this thing to happen.
Living Truth began broadcasting in the Philippines, first on one radio station in the north, and recently on a second one in the south. Hannah trusts that funds will come in as they are needed. It's a journey of faith.
We keep on hoping that this will go on and on by God's grace. If it is His will, this will go on and on.
Your presence, Your glory, You're welcome here. And all honor, dominion, Lord, please come near. We want You. We need You. We live to glorify Your name. Your name. Your presence. Your glory. Your welcome here. And all honor dominion. Lord, please come near. We want You. We need You. We live to glorify Your name. Oh, all honor and dominion.
presence, your glory, your welcome here. Lord, your welcome here. Lord, your welcome here.